No, that was a one-time thing. Hello, everybody. YouTube nobody, just Jargon here, back with another video about the king of swag himself, Joseph.
And it seems people are telling me, oh, looks like you got a little swag, bro. No.
Now, I'm sure a lot of you remember the documentary. It was one of my biggest videos, after all, and for a lot of you, it may have been your first introduction to my channel. That's why I thought it'd be good to sit down and discuss the details of it, and what's gone on since, and some other things that would have been out of place in an unbiased documentary. I did a similar video following up my documentary about movie unleashers as well. Think of these as a where are they now slash behind the scenes type video, because there have been quite a few things that have occurred after the Joseph documentary came out. I'd recommend you watch it before continuing, since a lot of the information I have to cover relies on knowledge in the first video, but it's not necessary. If it's been a while, or you still haven't seen it at all, I made an hour and a half long documentary on a man named Joseph Strickland, who is more commonly known online as Joseph8276. In 2013, Joseph uploaded videos to a YouTube account by this name where he made face cam rants about a variety of topics, but specifically about women's dating preferences and swag.
Welcome to my new channel, the Anti-Swag Corporation.
Usually, these videos were full of contradictions and hypocrisy that basically boiled down to the fact that he wanted women to lower their standards for him, but he wasn't willing to lower his standards.
You have to realize that looks really aren't everything. It's the personality you have to go after, ladies. And trolls, do not say contradict myself, because if you think that, you're dumb. I'm just not a big fan of big women. I don't hate them. I don't. I will say hi to them. And whatever, I'll talk to them. But I'm just not a big fan of going out with them.
However, Joseph's oddities go far deeper than that. And many have been eager to point that out. He was often the target of noteworthy commentary channels, including Leafy Is Here and Pyrocynical, but grew most infamy from the popular podcast known as The Drunken Peasants, which would ironically go on to feature Billy the Fridge as a host, a man who in the years prior had been the subject of Leafy videos himself, and one who I mentioned in my Leafy Victims video alongside Joseph. But back in my documentary, I left out one notable figure who's had a long history of discussing Joseph in great detail, that being Bass Shaman, a commentary streamer who focuses on infamous figures like Chris Chan. He'd made several videos about Joseph as well, and in fact, he's likely the one who's discussed Joseph the very most of anyone. But the reason I left him out of the video is simply because this is no longer the case. In late 2018, he deleted all of his content around Joseph, as well as other more controversial figures like Elliot Rodger and Randy Stair, the Spree Killers. This was due to the ripple effect from the Mumkey Jones deletions, where content relating to people such as this is taken down. Bass Shaman even lost his channel monetization for a brief bit as a result, and the following month would attempt to repost them in audio form to Spotify.
Bass Shaman podcast is now on Spotify, and season 3 is all of my old Joseph Strickland content. Season 2 is all of my old Randy Stair content, and Season 1 is all of my old Elliot Rodger content. Once I finish getting all the old stuff up that I'm going to put on here, I'll start a new season, which will be brand new stuff, and I cannot wait to discuss some new topics that I can't really talk about on YouTube. It's going to be fun.
For some reason, though, these audio files have all since been taken down. Still, a few newer streams have been made about Joseph, and I did happen to save one of the older ones for an edit I made in the months prior to the takedowns.
This is Joseph Strickland, an old school YouTuber. He was one of my favorite YouTubers to learn about back in the day. We used to cover him. We took a long hiatus, a long break from this journey, these sagas. But today we're diving back into this, okay? We're gonna enjoy some good old-fashioned Joseph Strickland.
But following this return to making Joseph-related content, and after my documentary had premiered, Bass Shaman uploaded a documentary of his own discussing Joseph's past as a whole, rather than just small sections of his content or personality.
Joseph Strickland is one of my favorite YouTubers of all time to listen to. Not because I agree with him. Most of the things he says I don't agree with at all. But because of the fact that he puts so much raw emotion into his content, into his videos. You know, known for his silly rant videos, things like that. But it's easy to forget that he was a human being, a real person with real emotions, right?
Like I said though, I left him out partially because I didn't have too many of them, and I know his videos didn't have any notable effect on Joseph himself, which was the ultimate point of the video. I've also run across about 24 smaller commentary channels about him, which I didn't mention for the same reason. Most people who discussed him were just riding off the coattails of bigger commentary channels and covering the problems with girls and what they should do video, like all the other ones had. One I have history with, known as Cheeseman, who had his Listen Up Ladies video shown for a few seconds, even reached out to say he liked the documentary. A small YouTuber who, while disconnected from Joseph's history, is actually incredibly ingrained in my history. I first ran into him in mid-2018 when recording the 5-part subscriber review special to celebrate hitting 1K. He'd made a video discussing movie unleashers that I saw in my sidebar, which I clicked on a whim and spent 30 minutes talking about while still recording. I remember saving the footage and eventually releasing it nearly 2 years later on April 1st, 2020 as a second channel video. Just for a joke. He had a little over 50 subs at the time of the original recording, but what I didn't know is that 6 months later I'd run into him yet again during the Jello Apocalypse drama, wherein this YouTuber posted a video titled Vote, trying to sway his audience politically. The video was taken down due to backlash, but the person to archive and re-upload it was none other than Cheeseman himself, which I discovered when I sought it out to upload my own video on the topic. And funnily enough, I think he was actually the one to give me the idea for making Review Recap in the first place. But he wasn't the only person to have seen my video and reached out. As many of you know, the documentary focused largely on the Kiwi Farms thread made about Joseph. Since each page is essentially a time capsule of events over the years, with many users offering up sources for research to one another who were curious about what was going on. The thread's creator and most active member by far was a user known as Parquet, someone who had also claimed responsibility for the creation of both archive channels, the Encyclopedia Dramatica page, and several of the troll girlfriends.
I've been following you for 20 years. So I knew about this audition because I follow you. And I learned everything about you by following you. So hire me, and you'll see who you truly are.
He's arguably the one who's created half the history surrounding Joseph, and is the most active documenter of it. So, when creating my video, I decided to take the opportunity to reach out to him directly by stating in a title card at the end of the video that I wanted to talk to him to learn more about what had happened. Did he respond? Well, yes, actually he did. And he even posted the Kiwi Farms thread to prove it was really him. Apparently, he enjoyed the video quite a lot, and confirmed that everything I stated was accurate, and even addressed some things he himself didn't know. But on the opposite side, he told me a few things that I myself didn't know, and helped me fill in some of the questions left unanswered in the original documentary. First off, the mysterious vertically shot videos that serve as the most recent footage of Joseph, which had been posted to the Chronicles of Swag archive channel just before it went inactive, were apparently from Snapchat. Which Joseph has, but is selective about who he adds as a friend. He stated that Joseph has actually resurfaced quite a few times before under new aliases, and Parquet only managed to follow him for so long by becoming a trusted friend who Joseph informs of his new accounts. But sometimes, especially on Facebook, Joseph would take very revealing usernames and use his actual face. To be honest, I should have found these in my research, but for some reason I didn't. One thing I did find out very early on, however, was that Parquet was truly a one-man army in this whole situation, because not only did he make the accounts, but he also did many of the minor things I alluded to in the video. For instance, when Joseph created the Ballin' Elite Extraction Force, or BEEF, Facebook group, Parquet joined under an alias and changed it to SWAG.
Hello everyone, welcome to the Ballin' Elite Extraction Force. We created this group in efforts to destroy the excrement and poison we know as swag.
Earlier that same day, Joseph mentioned getting a new friend, which may have been the account Parquet used.
Jack Silence? Shoutouts to you, man. You're one of the best Facebook buddies I have right now. You don't even live around where I do, but damn, you're cool anyway. Who cares? Dude, if you like metal, that's fine. If you like rock, that's fine. I don't care. But it's a good thing you hate skinny jeans, because me and you, dude, we gon' start a movement.
Since this was also the same day Joseph left Facebook for good, the issue with the Facebook group may have been why it happened. Parquet served as both of Joseph's troll girlfriends in 2017, Maria and Gina, which were done 2 days apart, by the way. I mentioned in my video that there was a contradiction since on Kiwi he claimed to have not known Maria was run by a troll, but apparently this was just a ruse. When asked by another user if Joseph may post more content, Parquet replied saying, quote, "There's a big possibility of that since he's talking to some chick," end quote. But later that same day, Parquet came back to the thread with new information. Quote, "Breaking, that girl was a troll and all new nudes have been leaked, oh my fucking god," end quote. Although, this conflicts with later statements. Parquet has claimed credit for the creation of the original Chronicles of Swag channel, and the owner of the new channel has stated to be the same person. However, this same individual also claimed credit for having trolled Joseph in this instance, something which Parquet seemed to have been unaware of prior. And by extension, this also means that Parquet released Joseph's complete set of nudes and docs information, since the ED page was created by him as well. Something which Parquet has expressed deep regret for having done. When we talked, he said that as fun as messing with Joseph was, he did take it too far at points. Joseph had another troll girlfriend in 2013 known as Kaylee McCarthy, but this was long before Parquet would discover Joseph.
As a matter of fact, I have a what's referred to as a Facebook girlfriend. Her name is Kaylee McCarthy, the one I just gave a shout out to. You know, she is a cool person. She lives pretty far away from me, so that doesn't give me the chance to meet her by any means, but I think she's cool. And this is going to be proof that I can definitely date somebody. Somebody true.
Members of 4chan apparently drove Joseph from YouTube and onto Facebook, which then stirred up the situation enough for Parquet to find him the following year before he departed from there as well for the same reasons. Parquet also mentioned the existence of a fourth troll girlfriend after the Maria and Gina saga, which had been the one to get Joseph to record the infamous video of himself masturbating that got posted to Pornhub by the troll. Apparently, this person had not been Parquet, but had informed him of what had gone on with Joseph during the exchanges. This person had created a fake account on Plenty of Fish, which Joseph apparently frequented quite a lot, and talked dirty like he had with his prior fake girlfriends.
Actually, in dating site terms, it would be a few extra pounds. Technically, I have a few extra...
What site is that from, a few extra pounds? That's from one of those dating sites. It's either from OkCupid or, Plenty of Fish. It's from one of
pounds.
Those two.
Although aside from the Pornhub video, the most shocking thing to come from this was the fact that the troll took things a step further and made a second account to talk to Joseph at the same time. And basically, got Joseph to cheat on the first girl like it was nothing. My God.
If you're loyal, you're good. If you're not loyal, you're a douchebag. For whoever thinks I wouldn't be loyal to a fucking girl, fuck you. I would be.
I guess this shouldn't be too surprising considering the fact that with Gina, Joseph did tell her she should leave her dying father just to come and give him sex, but cheating is something he took a firm stance against over and over and over again.
I'm loyal. I am that loyal. I'm not even joking. I'm that loyal.
I honestly thought he had run out of ways to be a hypocrite by this point, but I guess not. When the troll confronted Joseph about this using the handle of the first girlfriend, Joseph claimed she made him cheat, which I guess means he at least stood by one of his old points.
Girls, it's your fault.
Unfortunately, the DMs from this conversation were lost, since Parquet apparently had a tendency to not hold on to information very well, which is also why the Chronicles of Swag channel has gone dormant. The password for it went missing too. And just to confirm, yes, I know this is the real Parquet. He did post on Kiwi to prove it was him. He might be lying about some of this, but I at least know this is the guy who made the Kiwi thread. According to him though, the reason for losing a lot of the information is that the Joseph situation has been going on for over 7 years now. And Parquet himself has alluded to the fact that he's all but moved on now and is working a normal job that occupies a lot of his time. But during his years more active, he was very close with Joseph and discovered more about his life than he even let on Kiwi Farms. First, Joseph was in fact innocent of the charges he was accused of in 2015. Parquet stated that Joseph was caught in a Canadian sting operation to catch predators. And Joseph hadn't thought to ask the age of the people he was talking to, so he had no idea he was breaking laws when police caught him. He got the charges dropped mostly due to his autism, which was most likely why he behaved so carelessly in the first place. It may not have even crossed his mind to make sure everyone was over 18. And I'm not dismissing the fact that Joseph could have been lying about some of this to Parquet, but as far as we know, there's nothing else to suggest otherwise. On a different note, Parquet has also stated that despite Joseph's mental problems, his family is relatively normal and have tried helping his issues in the past. His uncle tried to get him to start working by giving Joseph a position at his shop, and had given him the laptop that Joseph first used to start making videos. Although when his uncle discovered this, and the reputation Joseph had created for himself online, he and Joseph's grandfather did their best to keep him off the internet for his own sake, especially after the charges. As I mentioned, Joseph's parents and grandmother died when he was a child, and his childhood home fell into the hands of his grandfather and uncle, who jointly own it. They have been Joseph's guardians ever since adolescence.
His rap songs back in the day, saying nizzle, shizzle, dizzle. Oh, there you go. Hey, Poppy. That was my grandfather, by the way.
Joseph does have two siblings as well, a younger brother who has a girlfriend and a kid while still living at home, must be torture to Joseph, and a sister who Parquet has stated is a bit off, but nothing like Joseph. Apparently she fixates heavily on relationship drama, is a heavy marijuana user, and an anti-vaxxer. But other than that, everyone in Joseph's family are very grounded people. The same, however, could not be said for Joseph's first and only real ex-girlfriend who was referenced in DMs exchanged between him and Parquet's fake girlfriends. In them, Joseph implied that she was a prostitute, and stole his money often.
What did she do?
Well, it started in 2015 when I was her boyfriend. Every month she'd take money from me on check day. And it's because of her stupid prostituting ways of trying to rip me off. Several chances for something fun. And while she'd give me a BJ, not often though, I broke up with her in mid-2016 because of money problems. I don't even get that much a month, and she takes like $250 for a blowjob in the summer of 2015. Her name is Stacy, and she is an awful person. Shit, at least you have a job, and overall you are a better person. Because of what she did to me those 2 years. She was a huge money hog, and always left me with less than $300 each month. Isn't that terrible, hun? I mean, she's awful.
From these DMs, it could be implied that Joseph was simply hiring a prostitute but mistook their interactions for a real relationship. Though there isn't enough information to know for sure. In the documentary, I went out on a limb somewhat and said that she may have been manipulating him, or Joseph was disillusioned about any relationship he thought they had. Turns out, I was completely right. His girlfriend, whose name is Stacy, by the way, ironic, I know, is confirmed to be a prostitute Joseph paid at one point. However, Parquet says that she'd purposely string Joseph along with sexual favors to get money off of him, something which he put up with out of sheer desperation. Sad part is, she never even considered him a boyfriend. So I guess technically, despite not being a virgin anymore, he never actually had a true girlfriend even after all this time. But the relationship he did have with her was ultimately toxic, and worried his entire family, who hated her for it. Joseph wasn't blind to these issues, but wanted a relationship so bad he stuck with her. Apparently, no one could help him. Except, ironically, Parquet himself. When he saw what was happening, Parquet grew angry about how she was treating him, and ultimately managed to push her away for Joseph's own sake. And this, to me at least, was truly interesting. I think what we all forget is that Parquet and Joseph have talked for nearly 6 years at that point, and on a regular basis. It's strange, but in a twisted way, they're almost genuine friends. Parquet has messed with him to no end, but regrets a lot of his harsher actions, and when the chips are down, stuck up for Joseph when no one else could. And I mean, just look at the troll girlfriends. Parquet never revealed to him that they were faked, or did anything overly cruel with them, which is something that separates him from trolls who have targeted people like Chris-Chan or others. I don't know, it may be because Parquet's mellowed out more as time has passed, or he's lost interest in messing with him, but either way, they have a very complex dynamic. It's almost like Batman and the Joker. They hate each other, of course, but beneath all that is some form of affection that defies all logic. I don't know, that's just my opinion. But it brings me to another point. I'm sure a lot of you have probably been curious what I myself think of Joseph, especially if you're subscribers to this channel and have noticed that documentary in particular was somewhat of a red herring in my backlog. My videos do tend to have a bit of my own opinions tossed in, and even though it's never the focus, I do tend to at least mention it. But I didn't for that video. The biggest reason is that no one else had ever portrayed Joseph in an unbiased light before. Like I said, videos on Joseph weren't uncommon, but they were universally negative, and I felt like if I was going to try to make the most complete historical documentation of his life, I didn't want to undermine any of the research by making people think that I went out to make fun of him. To be honest, I didn't, but I have laughed at him constantly, much like many of those whose videos preceded mine. Parquet also returned briefly to say that the only information he'd managed to acquire was that Joseph is bisexual by self-admission, and he stated that, quote, "I have to act straight because of being a baller and whatnot." Stated that, quote, and he stated that, quote, "I have to act..." I can't. I first found out about Joseph through Leafy's video, but after searching his name up afterwards, I found the first Drunken Peasant stream highlights, and it was some of the funniest content I'd ever seen. You have a group of great improv comedians commentating on one of the most laughable figures possible. I'll still watch the full compilation of the stream clips about Joseph every few months with friends or alone, to the point where I've almost memorized it. I'll even just sit and watch Joseph's raw videos sometimes, and it's still fun. Joseph is genuinely funny for the worst reasons. But that being said, do I still consider Joseph a sympathetic figure? Well, yes. He doesn't do himself any favors in his content. He comes off as completely obnoxious and self-pitying rather than someone like, say, Chris-Chan, who people do tend to feel sorry for a lot more despite sharing a lot of Joseph's traits. The reason being that Joseph spends all his time complaining about menial things like swag and girls' preferences, while not emphasizing the true tragedies in his life. Joseph lost both his parents when he was just a child, and then his grandmother. He was bullied ruthlessly throughout most of school, and grew up having to take special needs classes.
I'm in the learning center. People make fun of me.
because I'm in a learning center, and because I have autism, and because this and that, because they call me names, makes me want to say, I'm going to quit school, which might be the best thing to do, and the best idea yet, in my opinion, to quit school. Because I've already graduated, I don't need to go back another year.
None of these are excuses for his behavior, but it adds a lot more to his character that's important to remember when considering who he is as a person. Still, I do think he deserves a lot of what he gets. I think making comments at their expense on videos and making fun of their content and commentaries is just an inevitable reality, especially if someone chooses to respond to it as Joseph does.
My mother is the one who born me. And you're talking shit about her, you probably don't even know her. Trolls, stop. With the RIP comments, do not see me on cam. If you trolls keep doing this bullshit, me and my Facebook girlfriend, Kaylee McCarthy, will fuck your motherfuckers up right up the fucking ass with comments and fucking stuff.
And personally, I think it's completely fine to find humor in these situations, and be able to feel some amount of sympathy at the same time. I saw a lot of people commenting about how horrible it was for people to mock Joseph, but I don't think that's fair. But that being said, the reason I took the approach I did was because no one else had. So a lot of people had no idea Joseph even had a sympathetic side at all. And that's also why I styled the video as a down the rabbit hole. People asked why that was quite a bit, and the answer is pretty much, A, because it was funny, B, I'd wanted to talk about Frederick Knudsen's Down the Rabbit Hole series somehow, but figured this would scratch that itch better. C, the video was already not going to be like my others, and I figured the way I wanted to discuss Joseph lent itself to that style as well. And D, for a video as long as that one, editing things the way I typically do would be almost impossible, even if both myself and my editor worked on it together at full force. The slower paced visuals fit better with the tone anyway, and help keep the unbiased perspective I wanted to go for. A few people did get angry about me using his style, but I think most understood that it was intended as a one-off homage, which lots of YouTubers do all the time. I get where this comes from though, since it was jarring in an otherwise disconnected documentary about someone else. But when referring to the documentary itself, it's important to point out that following its release, a clip of Joseph would go viral and become a meme, specifically this one.
Welcome to my new channel, the Anti-Swag Corporation.
A few months after my video came out, I was at a friend's house and saw it play when her friends were gathered around the TV watching a meme compilation. I brushed it off until a while later when I found hundreds of Anti-Swag Corporation meme edits using that segment, all within a few months of the documentary's release at the peak of its popularity. And my god, some of them are pretty crazy.
Anyway, welcome to my new channel, the Anti-Swag Corporation.
The Anti-Swag Corporation is trying to run the world.
The Anti-Swag Corporation. Welcome to my new channel, the Anti-Swag Corporation.
There's new videos popping.
Oh my god, this one's really good. Joseph8276, the Beast documentary.
Welcome to my new channel.
I think this kind of became a meme, because I saw this in a meme compilation, his Welcome to the Anti-Swag Corporation.
The Rise of the Anti-Swag? Wait, what is this one? What's that? I want to see what that is.
I don't know when the Joseph documentary came out, but are all these...
These are all after yours came out.
Wait.
The earliest one was like May after we met.
Yeah. Did I start a meme without knowing it?
I think you did! Every single one is after your documentary came out.
Yeah, but what...
Me spawning in an Anti-Swag Corporation lockdown or Roblox?
I mean, this isn't a widespread meme, but there's a lot. Like, look at this. What did I create?
You did this, Jargon.
The meme never blew up on a mainstream level, but I still can't believe I started something like this. Joseph was widely known before, but it was the documentary that turned this particular line of his into an online in-joke. and that's pretty surreal to me. But another thing I also haven't mentioned is the fact that I wasn't the first to make a documentary on Joseph. There was another that came out 5 months prior called The Legend of Joseph8276 by Bundy's Move Out Productions. But this only made me want to take the unbiased route that much more, because this video took a more opinionated approach since it focused more on Joseph's content rather than his entire life. In fact, Bundy even helped me fine-tune the script as I was prepping the video, and was credited at the end for helping research. For the same reason, I'd also reached out to TJ Kirk, otherwise known as the Amazing Atheist and former Drunken Peasants host.
My favorite part of every Beast video is how he belabors every point and repeats the same points over and over again.
I asked him a series of questions about Joseph, specifically if he knew where the modern pictures of Joseph had come from that were shown in one of the later streams discussing him.
Have you guys seen the recent pictures of the Beast?
No,
dude.
Does he weigh like 700 pounds or something?
It looks like he fell into the Sarlacc pit and got digested for several years and then spit out.
Dude, we gotta find this. Paul, when was that taken?
I don't know. I just recently saw this on Twitter. Somebody posted it in September, so.
Damn.
Unfortunately, he couldn't tell me much since it was so long ago, so I didn't mention it in the video. There were also several things I discovered after having finished the documentary that slipped through me during the research phase. I already discussed Joseph's newer Facebook pages, but what's important to note is that not everything from his old Facebook survived over the years. He privated his account in early 2015, like I mentioned in my video, but his videos remained accessible via direct links or by those who had friended him on the account. Both Parquet and Bundy had access to these through alts or friends. But despite this, no new videos had reemerged from Joseph in years, before a random user known as Godzilla King of Kings uploaded one of Joseph's lost rants that he'd apparently posted, asking WWE game developers to include certain characters he liked.
This video is going to be on Facebook, and it's going to be posted on both in my videos and on 2K's page. Yes, the company 2K, which is creating WWE 2K15, will also get this video. And I'm sorry if Vince McMahon himself doesn't like this video, but it has to be said. Daniel Bryan's obviously going to be in the game. That's a good thing. Is Jericho going to be in the game? I hope so.
By some weird coincidence, he uploaded this less than a week before my video went out. And meanwhile, I myself managed to find a deleted YouTube rant that by some miracle survived in the Wayback Machine. This was Joseph's video on loyalty. Funny in retrospect, I know. But this had only survived through snippets using Cody Briscoe's 2014 commentary on it, which he'd gotten from a now-deleted re-upload channel.
Hey guys, this week's commentary is on YouTube user... I actually don't know their name. I got this video from a mirror a long time ago, so the title is probably not even the same video title.
I saved both these videos, and thankfully so, since the YouTuber who posted the first would later delete his channel. You ever wonder if maybe that was actually Joseph himself? That was actually a new channel of his that just re-uploaded? I really doubt it, but it's possible. Parquet now has both videos as well, though being locked out of his channel, there's not much he intends to do with them, I don't think. I'm not sure whether more content from Joseph will ever resurface, but I guess this just shows it's never impossible. As for Joseph today, I've discovered bits and pieces of information, but nothing too groundbreaking. He still lives in his childhood house despite being nearly 30 today, and to my knowledge is still under safeguard by his family who's limiting his internet access. And still to this day, he has not found another girlfriend. He's lost touch with Parquet for the most part, but the two do still catch up every now and then, telling him about whatever new social media he creates on Twitter, Facebook, or anything else before abandoning it shortly. Apparently, Parquet is good friends with Joseph's former best friend, who posted chat logs about him on the Drunken Peasant subreddit, which I was still unable to find to this day. But it seems that Joseph has lost touch with nearly everyone, so this information is far from current. And I don't know exactly what was in it. It seems that with the passage of time, the situation has mellowed. Maybe for good. Joseph is keeping a low profile, and Parquet appears to have largely refocused on other things. It appears as if both of them have gone their separate ways. Joseph remains largely unchanged, but keeps out of the public eye. Maybe his war on the internet is behind him, and maybe that's for the best. Parquet has withdrawn in a similar way, and has moved on to other facets of life. He expressed the desire to give a statement on Joseph himself as a final word on everything that's happened and his views on it. To cap off this story and his involvement with it, for the very last time. And for the sake of true closure, I can't think of a better way to end the video than with the final words of the man who was there from the beginning. This is what he had to say. The person Joseph is quite similar to his beast persona that we've all come to know on YouTube. He still holds and values many of the opinions expressed in his videos, and is so set on his views to the point of stubbornness. He's really committed in his ways and doesn't take criticism very well, even if the criticism is given to help him improve in certain aspects of his life. It's his way or it's nothing. Joseph's fixation on relationships is very unusual. Aside from his ridiculously high standards, contradictions, and selfish needs, his reasoning for wanting a relationship is to have a future. To the beast, if he were to have a girlfriend, she would take care of him and his needs emotionally and financially. She would not be allowed to talk to other guys or have friends, as he would be afraid his girlfriend might cheat on him despite having been unfaithful himself. His views on relationships are very controlling, one-sided, and even highly obsessive and possessive. But many of us already know that through his rant videos. His ex was a prostitute that manipulated him into giving her money for favors and mistaken that transaction for a relationship. From what I know, he still goes back to her despite the trouble she causes him. He had a crush on a female friend of his, but she didn't feel the same. At one time, he walked to her house, but she wasn't there, so he took it upon himself to sit on her porch for a couple of hours to wait on her, but her mother showed up early only to rush him away. Most of his days are spent going on walks, loitering at the Legion, playing GTA, WWE 2K, and Forza on Xbox. Also spending most of his time in NSFW roleplaying slash furry character forums. Tim Hortons is his favorite location to go to hang out as well. Other than that, that's all he does. He has a very small social circle, and despite that, some of his friends aren't very supportive. Some have even taken advantage of him in terms of money or weed. They're like-minded like Joseph and share most of the same opinions as he does. I guess the term "your vibes attract your tribe" rings true. He had one good friend, but became very neglectful towards them and ultimately ended the friendship. But most of the time, he keeps to himself for long periods of time with no interaction. Overall, the beast was unique in some good ways, but mostly bad ways. A polarizing pariah that caught the attention of many curious followers of his rants and trolls hell-bent on destruction. His views and opinions will live forever in infamy and be a part of internet history. The ride has been wild, but to every trip there is an end, and to every book there's a final chapter. This is the chapter to close the book on this insane ride.
It's negotiation. Sure, for me, I was not.